Dear Christians unconcerned about racial justice, why not cut out of your Bibles when Christ refers to his work, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound." Well, that's the pointed question that Ellen White left with members of the Woodland, California Church as she closed her July 1880 letter to them. They were antagonistic to political measures for racial justice, and that question is what she wanted them to ponder as they absorbed her letter. And that's how we concluded part two of this series. 15 years later, Christ's announcement of his kingdom mission in Luke 4, quoting Isaiah 61, would again be the scriptural anchor for Ellen White in a series of articles published in the Review during the mid-1890s, compiled in the Southern Work, first published in 1898 by her son Edson White. In this series of articles, Ellen White urged Adventists to undertake a risky mission to reach the black population held under racial oppression in the American South. So how would the politics of racial justice figure into that mission? Did Ellen White end up a sellout to segregation? That's our question in this, the third and last segment of our look at Ellen White and the politics of racial justice. My name is Douglas Morgan, and I'm truly grateful to you for taking the time to join in this exploration. Now, a reminder that this three-part presentation corresponds to articles on the Spectrum magazine website. Well, Ellen White herself framed the context for the question that we're considering. She did this in 1908 when she wrote, "Much might have been accomplished by the people of America if adequate efforts in behalf of the freedmen had been put forth by the government and by the Christian churches immediately after the emancipation of the slaves. Money should have been used freely to care for and educate them at the time they were so greatly in need of help. But the government, after a little effort, left the Negro to struggle unaided with the burden of his difficulties." So we note that she's saying that some commendable effort had been made, but it had not been adequate. It was especially inadequate in duration, as signaled by the Compromise of 1877 that we looked at last time. The government, after a little effort, left the Negro to struggle unaided. Unaided against white supremacists who used terror and violence to regain control of the southern state governments. Unaided as these white redeemers, so-called because they won back political control lost during Reconstruction, proceeded, in the words of historian Harvard Sitkoff, to reduce blacks to a state of peonage, to disregard their civil rights, and to disenfranchise them by force, intimidation, and statute. W.E.B. Du Bois, whose scholarly tome, Black Reconstruction in America, extended to 746 pages, encapsulated the tragedy in a single devastating sentence. "The slave went free, stood for a brief moment in the sun, then moved back again toward slavery." As Ellen White acknowledged, the Seventh-day Adventist Church failed to act its part during this period of opportunity marked by Reconstruction and its gradual close, which, in a sense, extended as late as the early 1890s. But it was just as that period was reaching its final close that Adventists, most notably through the initiative taken by the prophet's son, Edson White, we're finally getting serious about reaching black people in the South. Using that iconic steamship, the Morning Star. I'd like to take the opportunity at this moment to note that Ron Grable's book, Mission to Black America, first published in 1970, has recently been published in a revised new edition by Oak and Acorn Press, and I highly recommend it to you. I've just reread it myself, and it's really an enjoyable and engaging narrative that helps one really understand and get into this remarkable episode in our history. But anyway, just as these efforts were getting underway, the Supreme Court of the United States in Plessy versus Ferguson, 1896, in effect put a national seal of approval on racial segregation. During the years spanning the turn of the century, about 1895 to 1910, Jim Crow became a pervasive and legal social system for keeping black citizens separate and unequal. The Reconstruction experiment in interracial democracy met its final and complete demise, replaced by an authoritarian regime of racial repression. The Southern states invented a variety of means for thwarting the 15th Amendment, preventing an overwhelming majority of black citizens from exercising the right to vote. As we pointed out last time, a total of 14 African Americans served in the House of Representatives in Congress during the Reconstruction period, but that number was reduced to one by the turn of the century. George White of North Carolina, pictured on the right here, his term concluded in 1901, and after that, there would be no African Americans in Congress for nearly three decades. Well, Ellen White believed that more than 250 years of slavery created a heavy debt upon the American nation. And as quoted earlier, she believed that both the government and the church had a role in making good on that debt. She adapted her program for rectifying racial injustice to this new context in which conventional politics, any semblance of free and fair elections and representative democracy, freedom of speech, none of that was available as an instrument for advancing the well-being of black Americans in the South. So she urged her church to undertake a comprehensive initiative that would bring to bear everything that Adventism had to offer towards holistic restoration of human beings to the flourishing for which they were created. This would help the formerly enslaved, their children, their grandchildren, and their great-grandchildren to claim their equal dignity as sons and daughters of God and their God-given freedom to discover and follow the way of Christ for themselves. It would entail teaching them to read and to follow various trades and engage in different business enterprises. She called on farmers, financiers, builders, and craftsmen to join ministers and teachers in this broad-ranging mission and thereby make the best restitution that can be made to those who have been robbed of their time and deprived of their education. This agenda challenged the status quo. The Adventist prophet insisted that the cotton field will not be the only resource for a livelihood to the colored people. And she did this at the very time in which the ascendant forces of white supremacy were engaged in a systematic effort to see that it was. It was a high-risk adventure. Just as soon as people begin to make any kind of movement to educate the blacks, there are some who are determined that it shall not be done. Ellen White observed that in 1907. Well, a few years before, her son, Edson, and his colleagues in the Southern Missionary Society had gotten a taste of that determination. The whole difficulty arose from our efforts to aid the colored people, Edson explained, regarding mob violence that they encountered in Calmer, Mississippi, May 1899. We had taught them some better ideas about farming, introduced different seeds such as peanuts, beans, and so forth, that bring a high price. And this the whites would not stand. Only in the context of the foregoing, what we've just said, both the consolidation of the white supremacist rule over the southern states that we've looked at this time, and what we've looked at previously in parts 1 and 2 about Ellen White's earlier outspokenness for racial justice. Only with these in mind can we begin to understand her counsel on politics during this 1895 to 1910 period. And once again, a classic by Ron Grable really remains unsurpassed as a starting point if you want to dig a little deeper and get a strong understanding of what was going on in this period and how Ellen White's counsel related to it. And you can get E.G. White and Church Race Relations in PDF form at the General Conference Archives website in the books section. Well, Ellen White's admonitions against, during this period, against becoming absorbed in politics, giving our minds to political issues, making political speeches, or agitating the color line or social equality, these may strike many in the 21st century as disappointing, even deplorable. And so they should, if presented, as for decades they were, without context, as timeless maxims, inspired dictates that define Ellen White's legacy for the politics of racial justice. If treated as such, her earlier insistence that authentic Adventism requires outspokenness for racial justice in America must somehow be minimized or marginalized or attributed to a change, a compromise of principle that at best taints and at worst completely undercuts her legacy as a guide for race matters today. But what if the 1895 to 1910 cautions do not constitute a change in direction, but an adaptation in a specific time and place for the purpose of moving forward in the same direction? See, rhetoric that might be edifying clarity and powerful motivation for truth and righteousness in one context might be a reckless invitation for brutal recrimination in another context. And in the history that we're looking at, such repression would have damaged and possibly destroyed the church-based endeavor to create alternative structures for black advancement, especially when those efforts were already held in suspicion by the powers that be. So this leads to suggesting the addition of a third main point or guidepost from Ellen White's ministry to what we've already tried to establish. Just reviewing previously, we've said that on the one hand, those who speak under the banner of the Adventist message cannot dabble in politics. But the second point we tried to establish last time was that Adventist faith should not be silent about injustice, exploitation, or inhumanity, even if that advocacy stirs opposition. But now, let's add a third one. Wisdom is needed to discern between courage on the one hand and mere bravado on the other hand, between faithfulness on the one hand, faithfulness come what may, okay? Discern between that, but when might that simply be unnecessary provocation? I don't think there's any simple formula for working that out, but in a letter to Franklin E. Belden in 1899, Ellen White reaffirmed the mandate upon believers both to act for racial justice and to be discerning about how best to do so in the time and place in which they are situated. God calls upon Christians, high and low, to represent Christ in their treatment of the colored people. God calls for his workers to consecrate themselves to the cause of justice and reform. The age in which we live calls for decided reformatory action. But wisdom must be exercised in dealing with a race that has so long been degraded and abused. That which is now undertaken cannot be carried forward as it might have been had the white churches at the time of the abolition of slavery acted as Christ would have done in their place. The priority that Ellen White placed on racial justice throughout her prophetic career and the passion of her advocacy for it, I think, lays down a challenge for us. The guideposts from her witness considered in the light of prayerful, Christ-centered reflection on Scripture leave us with a question. What am I called to do as a co-laborer with Christ for racial justice in the fall of 2020? Thanks so much for listening. I hope these presentations have been helpful to you. I also want to thank Dr. Benjamin Baker, the creator and curator of blacksdahistory.org, for the opportunity to have these presentations appear on that platform. And also my thanks to Alyssa Williams, managing editor of Spectrum Magazine, for publishing the articles online. Thanks again for taking the time to view and listen. This is Doug Morgan. Peace.